The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. All the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is greater than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being now torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals, and the angels were ministering to him. The word of our Lord. I'll ask Art to come and share the good news.
Good morning again.
I'm a little too far away.
That's better. I can see the whites of your eyes. Oh, yes. We're talking about good news. And that was the beginning of Jesus' mission that we just heard read there, when he started to preach good news, repent and follow the ways of the Lord. We live in a world of conflict, suffering, hopeless situations, but if we open our eyes and look for, we will see lots of good news as well. Now this is going to be your, I know this is a little, is the sound okay or is it too loud? Okay, here we go. Must be my hearing aids. This is going to be your good news report from the Good News Network. Rondine, which means swallow. In Italy, a one-of-a-kind school sees Palestinians graduating alongside Israelis, Americans with tribal origins alongside those with European origins, and Bosnian Muslims next to Orthodox Serbs, all in the name of creating a generation of interfaith peace builders. The Swallow Citadel of Peace, located in a medieval campus in the hills of Tuscany near the city of Arezzo, offers a variety of higher educational programs and degrees, but it comes with a catch. Prospective students must live with the enemy, either those of domestic ethnic group or a neighboring nation, all in the name of deconstructing the reasons behind their hatred and conflict, breaking the trance of viewing people as the other and returning to their nations as peace builders. In this time of ethnic conflicts all over the world, where a generation has been brought up tending plants sown by seeds of conflict four or five generations in the past, it could be the most important school on earth. We didn't want to build a utopian place where students could pretend war doesn't exist, explains Franco Vaccari, co-founder and president of Rondine. We wanted, rather, to create a neutral ground away from the chaos of their homelands and bigger Western cities where our students could focus on a peaceful dialogue. Interesting. The school called Rondine, which means swallow in Italian, offers various degrees like a master's program in conflict management and humanitarian action. Students arrive and begin an intensive course in Italian language and then proceed to study interfaith dialogue, methodological and leadership skills to deconstruct the idea of the enemy and reconciliation. At the end of their journey, they are required, as per the scholarship, to go back to their country of origin and lead a peace-building and reconciliation program for 1 year. Ruzica Markovic is one such student. She talked to Christian Science about her progress. A Bosnian Croat born in the aftermath of the Balkans War, which saw ethnically motivated killing of 100,000 people across the region, she has since graduated and returned home to hold interfaith cafe events, conferences, and summer camps focused on reconciliation. I learned to see the other person as myself, a being with emotions, challenges, pain, frustrations, maybe some traumas. That's the lesson I brought back home. Here's another good news story. Locals are interrupting violence one lawn chair at a time in Minneapolis. As city officials wrangle under the pressure to reduce urban violence and deal with demands from police unions, homeowners associations, and gun lobbyists, residents in some of the most violent neighborhoods in the country have opted instead to pull up a chair and have a sit down. One such movement has been the 21 Days of Peace event in Minneapolis, a place where, even before the death of George Floyd, sometimes saw 11 homicides a month. Here, community and church congregation members are simply seating themselves in lawn chairs on street corners in the most dangerous neighborhoods and acting as violence interrupters. And police statistics show it's working. Compared to last summer, in June 2021, homicide numbers took a dive during the 21 Days of Peace and continued to stay low in the following months, along with incidents of rape and aggravated assault. Our group asked the Minneapolis Police Department to identify the most dangerous spots in our neighborhood, the 4th Precinct, and then we went there, pulled out our chairs, and sat down, write Louis King and Jerry McAfee in an op-ed in the Washington Post. King is president and chief executive of Summit Academy OIC in Minneapolis, and McAfee is pastor of the city's New Salem Missionary Baptist Church, but both are part of this new wave of violence interrupters. Too many leaders are responding by adopting a Nixonian tough-on-crime stance, which usually translates into over-policing and under-supporting these communities, they wrote. The police, the people sitting on these corners in their chairs are members of the community. We know our young people and they know us. Similar movements of violence interruption have broken out with success in Nashville, where the groups Gideon's Army and the West Nashville Dream Center are working through community outreach to rebuild trust and using successful de-escalation to decrease crime by 40% while arrests plummeted. AP reports that in areas where the Dream Center operates, crime has fallen 40%. That's pretty good, 40%. Giving a totally new perspective to police departments that for years had adopted tough on crime policies. We thought that was going to make it safer. And what we ended up doing was breaking down trust in those communities, said Police Lieutenant Jason Picanzo, who works with West Nashville Dream Center. Now he says It's the community that has made these neighborhoods safer. Back in Minneapolis, King and McAfee believed that the moral bastion of the Black church gives them a unique advantage over the police forces. They cite similar examples in Baltimore, where church groups are doing more for underserved communities and at the same time reducing violence. We draw on the power of congregation, of family, of friends, and of community to try to interrupt the violence, and our faith gives us the courage to put ourselves in harm's way, they wrote. It's a strong gesture to unfold a lawn chair and simply sit where many people fear even to drive. Violence of any kind, whether it involves us or not, is a difficult situation to risk being caught up in, but desperate times also call on our better angels, and these Minnesotans are stretching their wings. We're not declaring victory by any means, but as elected officials look for answers to end the violence, they would be wise to pull up a chair and take a look at what's working. Here's another one. The largest ever study of real life conflicts captured by closed circuit TV. Researchers found that bystanders will intervene in 9 out of 10 public fights to help victims of aggression and violence. The findings, which were published in the journal American Psychologist, overturn our long-held beliefs from previous decades that victims are ignored by those in their vicinity. Instead of confirming this common misperception, the international research team of social scientists discovered that at least one bystander, and typically several, did something to help. And when more people are nearby, there is even greater likelihood that at least one person will intervene to help. Researchers from the University of Copenhagen in the Netherlands, Institute of Study of Crime and Law Enforcement, and Lancaster University examined video recordings of 219 arguments and assaults in the inner cities of Amsterdam, Lancaster, UK, and Cape Town, South Africa. According to conventional wisdom, non-involvement is the default response of bystanders during public emergencies, said lead author Dr. Richard Philpott of Lancaster University and University of Copenhagen. Challenging this view, the current cross-national study of video data shows that intervention is the norm in actual aggressive conflicts. The fact that bystanders are much more active than we think is a positive and reassuring story for potential victims of violence and the public as a whole, he added. We need to develop crime prevention efforts which build on the willingness of bystanders to intervene. Using the 3 urban security cameras which captured aggressive public fights breaking out, 91% of the time, bystanders watching the incidents intervened to physically gesturing for an aggressor to calm down, physically blocking an aggressor or pulling an aggressor away, and consoling the victim. The research further showed that a victim was more likely to receive help when a larger number of bystanders was present. The most important question for the potential victim of a public assault is, will I receive help if needed? While having more people around may reduce an individual's likelihood of helping, i.e. the bystander effect, it also provides a larger pool from which help givers may be sourced. The study also found no difference in the rates of intervention between the 3 cities, even though inner city Cape Town is generally perceived to be less safe. Researchers suggest that it is not the level of perceived danger that sets overall rate of helping, rather, it is any signal that the situation is conflictual and requires intervention. The consistent helping rate found across different national and urban contexts supports earlier research suggesting that third-party conflict resolution is a human universal with a plausible evolutionary basis. In contrast to the idea that we live in a walk-on-by society where people never get involved, the high levels of intervention found in this study across different national and urban borders suggests that intervention is the norm in real life inner city conflicts. More good news. Here's another one, the Beijing Blue, proving that change is possible if the will to create it is present. Chinese megacities like Beijing that were once famous for their apocalyptic gray skies are enjoying the lowest levels of air pollution they've experienced in the 21st century, falling 42% from an average high in 2013. The change has increased the lifespan of Chinese urbanites by 2.2 years. That's pretty good. The news comes from a report published by the University of Chicago called the Air Quality Life Index, which listed some of the actions taken by Chinese government to reduce air pollution, described by the CCP as a war on pollution. Included reducing the presence of heavy industry like steel production in city centers, as well as restricting coal power plants from being built inside cities while shuttering those that were already there. Some cities like Beijing have reduced the number of cars allowed on the roads during peak hours, similar to London's congestion charge. Lastly, China's mass urban tree planting campaigns have been well documented. While life expectancy has risen 2.2 years on the average, some cities have seen far more drastic increases. Citizens living under the new Beijing Blue are predicted to live 4 additional years, while those 11 million in north central city of Boding are predicted to gain 6 years. At the foundation of those actions were common elements, political will and resources, both human and financial, that reinforced each other. When the public and policymakers have these tools, action becomes much more likely. In fact, the decline in China's pollution levels has been so drastic, it has lowered the world average, which report says would have increased if not for the Middle Kingdom's war on pollution. Although Chinese city air is still several times higher than the WHO's recommended minimum, it shows what is accomplishable with the political and civic effort, particularly to its neighbors in South Asia, where the report warns air quality is worsening. So there's good news. I need that because I get a little depressed, quite frankly, I do. And we pray for people. And who are you praying for? People are sick, people are dying, families and people died. I mean, that's all. If you feel that as the Bible and the Spirit tells us that God feels that, and that we share in that heart of God for his creation. God sees little sparrows fall and it touches his heart. And everyone else who is falling or fallen or hurting, we need good news. So this is good news. Here's a couple more headlines. Scientists surprised to find how important it is to have a visual diet rich in kindness over cuteness. Kindness is more important than cuteness. Honda is going to introduce 10 new electric motorcycles and scooters to ease air pollution in Asia's megacities. Now here's one. A simple bacteria spray could solve India's air pollution and also enrich local farmers. The science of kindness. Biology proves how we are all connected. We are all connected. So these are all from the Good News Network, which you can look up on the interweb and see what's going on there, the Good News Network. Then, of course, we have the ultimate good news. God who created us, God who loves us, God who sent Jesus to teach us how to live and to die for us, to forgive us. gives us new, abundant life, gives us the Holy Spirit with fruit. But when this Holy Spirit controls your lives, He will produce this kind of fruit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So in this world of conflict and suffering and hopeless situations, we pray for those who are suffering, victims and perpetrators, and we feel their pain, as we should. But remember, there's lots of good news out there. And God is still King of Kings, Creator, and Sovereign over all. God's will be done. And we think on these things. Amen.